This is Whitley Strieber, and this is a Dreamland video presentation. You have reached the edge of the world. Today on Dreamland, we're going to start with a rather unusual thing. Something happened here in this apartment a few days ago that was recorded on my surveillance system. Specifically, it was two cracks like booms in quick succession, accompanied by a flash. Video analysis has revealed that the flash and the booms are not synchronized. In other words, there was something off about them. They're not caused by the same thing. The booms sounded to me like gunshots, and you'll hear that, I'm sure, when you listen to them. And they frightened me because this is the second time it's happened in 3 weeks, and I feared that somebody is coming here and trying to maybe kill me. There's always a danger in this crazy world. They happened at about the same time, just at 4 o'clock in the morning. The first time they happened, the surveillance system was not on, and I was doing my usual early morning meditation, and the two flashes were intense, and the explosions were ferocious. They scared me to death, but I've been meditating a long time, and I ended up being able to more or less use it to my advantage to pull myself together again and keep going. The second time it happened, about the same time of day, I was not here, and it was also recorded, as you'll hear me discussing with Linda, on the Neighbors app. Now, in addition to the discussion with Linda about this, we're going to add a number of recordings that she sent me of similar things. They're not quite the same because the booms are not as crisp. And also, if you listen closely to my recording, there's a sound that starts just before the booms. The video analyst who looked at it felt like the light was coming from above. There's a very brief flash of light that's been analyzed quite carefully, frame by frame. And so there you have it. Now, the interview with Linda itself and the interview that follows, which I'll talk about in just a moment, are audio only. But the video of the booms and the surveillance video is obviously not audio. Now, the second thing we're going to do on Dreamland this week is to interview Mia Feroleto about the last conference that she had up in South Dakota a week and a half ago now. I was there, and I once again, if you read my journal entry that I posted about it, I once again had visions into the other universe, the mirror universe. It remains one of the strangest things that's ever happened to me. I consider it completely inexplicable, but it happens. I try to describe experiences as accurately as I can, even though I have many that I don't understand. And this is certainly one of them. And you'll hear me and Mia discussing that and other things that went on at this remarkable conference, frankly. And I'm sorry it's the last one Mia will ever do, but this is her decision. And I think you're going to find the discussion we have about it together absolutely fascinating. So let's go on, and we will temporarily stop the video and listen to the interview with me and Linda Moulton Howe. And then afterwards, those of you who have video or are watching on YouTube can watch the videos of the various surveillance cameras and the booms, including my own. And those of you who are listening will hear, of course, what's on these videos. And you can go to unknowncountry.com and watch them if you wish by clicking through to the video section. It will be in the free part of Dreamland as well as the subscriber area. I'd like to once again welcome Linda Moulton Howe to Dreamland. We're going to spend some time together, not the whole show, but half an hour or so, discussing something very unusual that has happened, and Linda discussed it plenty of times on her Earth Files YouTube channel, not to be missed every Wednesday evening, and on her website, earthfiles.com, which are unusual booming noises. Now, oddly enough, the reason we are talking about this today and comparing notes is this happened to me on July the 23rd at 3:56 a.m. in this apartment. Now, I was not here on that day, but my surveillance system was on, and it recorded what you will hear in just a few moments and see on the video of what happened in here in this apartment. Now, about 2 weeks before, the same thing happened. I was in the living room at the time, and the sounds were very dramatic. I was doing my 3 o'clock a.m. meditation, and suddenly there were two sounds, bang, bang. I thought they were gunshots. There were flashes associated with them, and I was shocked. I thought that maybe someone was having a shootout, frankly. I mean, in this day and time, that could be happening. And I wondered if someone wasn't trying to interrupt my meditation. A lot of people know I meditate at that hour, and maybe some people don't like it. In any case, a few weeks later, on July the 23rd, it happened again. This time, I was not here, and the surveillance system was on. But also this time, a number of people on the Neighbors app, where people record thefts and unusual events in their immediate neighborhoods, reported the sounds. They were all within a square quarter mile of this apartment. My apartment is on the southern edge of where the reports occurred, and the northern edge is about 1,100 feet due north of my apartment. There were about four reports from that period, one of whom also has it on surveillance video, apparently, and recorded the precise time as well. Linda, now first, of course, welcome back to Dreamland after that long intro. I'm so glad you're here.
Thank you, Whitley, and your recounting is fascinating to me because, as you know and a lot of Dreamland listeners know, I have been investigating and reporting about booms and other strange above in the air and below in the ground sounds since January of 2011. And since then, there has been an evolution in both the sound and the quality, and the boom sound that you have just described, where it goes boom, boom, like two knocks, that is what made its very first appearance in all of my decade-long investigations of these sounds on March 10th of 2012. And this was in San Diego, where they had TV and not 2012, 2021, in 2021, so only 4 months ago. And they had a headline that was in the Fox television channel 5, Mystery Boom Shaking Reported Around San Diego, March 10th, 2021. And then on the ground in the San Diego and La Jolla region of Southern California, there were headlines that started going around that day, Mystery Boom Shaking Reported Around San Diego. And that was before the 5 p.m. Pacific time on TV and social media. And even in the Fox 5 news studio that day, Wednesday, March 10th, some of the employees, quote, heard these boom noises and felt the shaking both at the station and in another area called Kearney Mesa. And they had reports that were coming into the television station from people who were at their home were in work because of COVID. So it means that there was a lot of interaction with people working for Channel 5 who were at home or were downtown inside of the studio. And then within minutes, the newsroom received phone calls from viewers that ranged from El Cajon to Ramona, and they were all reporting the same similar mysterious, shaking, rattling impacts, and they said it was like a hitting sound, so that it had a double to it, which is the first time since 2011 that I have heard people, this many people, TV, police, people who in their houses were hearing boom, boom. And that sounds like what you heard.
Yeah, well, that's exactly what I heard. Boom, boom. And as you will hear when we play the videos, we're going to play them all in sequence. Linda's got some and mine as well. And, of course, I was very worried because they sounded like gunshots. And yet, I had a video expert, an audio expert, listen to them and watch them. And he said some very interesting things. There are flashes associated with them, which you can barely see in the video. He said the flashes are not coordinated with the sounds, meaning either that the flashes were very far or the sounds were very physically distant from the flashes, or that something else is going on. And he also said that the two booms were very closely in proximity to one another, suggesting it wouldn't be fireworks, but something else. But I'm wondering, Linda, do any of the videos that you have flashes in them as well?
I had one that was at Earth Files for about 5 years, and we should have embedded it. That was one of those lessons. It had been there going all the way back to 2012, I believe, from Massachusetts. And it was a security camera facing out from the front porch of a house in Salem, Massachusetts. And on this security camera, you see and hear almost simultaneously, like sheet lightning. It's like white light comes across the entire frame with, and that's the question, is it in anticipation of? It seems to me that I always thought that the light anticipated the sound, but it could be that it was slightly off, but they are pretty much the same, and that was the best security camera flash of light with a huge boom all the way back to the, we'll call it the beginning of these mysterious sounds.
You know, there were, way back in the 90s, there were booms being recorded over the Los Angeles area, like sonic booms that were not explained. I happen to know someone who was involved in a program at that time which would have created sonic booms, but and was run out of Edwards Air Force Base, but it was not them. They were quite certain of that, and they were extremely concerned about it because they didn't know where the booms were coming from either. This must have been like 1995 or so, so it's been a long time. But, you know, in this case, I felt a very personal sense of this because this is my primary meditation time. It's a very deep, profoundly productive meditation where I am often in contact with a presence or something, and perhaps even my wife, I think, in some cases. Very profound contact, and it's fruitful because if without that meditation, the three books I've just finished over the past few years, Afterlife Revolution, A New World, and Jesus, A New Vision, could not have been written. And quite frankly, all three books are quite advance of an advance over all of my previous work in a lot of different ways.
Mm-hmm.
So it's an important time. And to see it interrupted like that was a little scary.
Well, whether this is comforting or not, let's just flip back again to March 10th, 2021, about 4 months ago. And this goes along with the first description that I gave you. This is a second. This is an ear witness that I interviewed for my Earth Files YouTube channel. And he and his wife, on the morning of March 10th, 2021, they were at home in a place called South Park, which is about 4 miles northeast of downtown San Diego. Because he is a professional independent marketing consultant, he asked me not to give out his real name or to be absolutely precise about the location beyond South Park. But he, his description, and his wife was there as well, backing him up. It is important because of your experience. He said, "Now I've heard these booms twice. I heard it in February 16th and the second one on March 10th, this day we're talking about when it went all over the entire San Diego area. And I was at both times, I was here at our house." He says, "I was sitting in the main part of our house, and we have these glass panels that actually open up completely, like in an accordion to the side, and so the side of the house is open. But that day, they were closed, and we live in an area where planes do go overhead, but this sound was nothing like that. We looked, but there was nothing we could see when it happened. And it was a sound that came and hit twice. It made a boom, boom. We do not understand what it was. It was definitely repeated at the same volume, the same intensity, one right after the other." And then he said, "That night, I saw a local reporter," meaning San Diego area, "who had mentioned something. And I said, oh, wow, other people are hearing this." And then they went to Twitter, and they saw in Twitter, quote, "Anybody else hear these sounds?" And then he started to reply, and eventually it led to me, and I interviewed him. And this is the first time of the period of what I call the double knock knock sounds, and that's what you heard as well.
You know, it's fascinating that this would come right to my front door and get recorded there too. I just wonder, because it seems now as we're talking that this must be anomalous. This is not someone firing off a gun in order to interrupt my meditations and scare the hell out of me, which it certainly did the first time.
And he stressed this was not a gunshot. He said this was something that had oomph to it. Boom, boom, which is different than a gunshot.
Well, mine was crisper. It could have been a gunshot, although the expert didn't think it was either. It was crisper, but the other thing I thought, could it be a sonic boom? And it was too localized. In other words, if it had been a sonic boom, everyone in the whole of West Los Angeles would have heard it, not just people in a very localized little area like this. If it had been a gunshot, it wouldn't have been heard, the two sounds would have been gunshots. They wouldn't have been heard except immediately in my immediate area, and people a quarter of a mile north of here would not have picked them up.
Or right.
Not at 3 o'clock in the morning anyway. They would have been too faint. So it was something from above, and the light was also from above. And you can tell the light, if you look closely, you can see that it's coming in the top of the window. So something up there did that. And I have to wonder what it is, because, you know, I live in a situation where I have missing time experiences in this apartment, all kinds of odd things. There's a reason my friends call it the unquiet flat. And, you know, Mark Sims has these radios that he tunes to 144.1, and if you wait and you do mental requests or send out signals, you can get signals back, but not in this apartment. In this apartment, it never stops. I'll turn a radio, just picked one up now. I'll turn it on and we can listen, knowing what will happen. Now, that's on a frequency that's not supposed to have any signal. It's reserved for Morse code. But in this apartment, and if you take that radio out of the apartment, if you walk out the door, it'll go silent. So something's going on in here for sure.
Yeah, and was that a very harsh sound right then coming through that frequency?
Yeah, 144.1. Which, if folks get a radio that can be tuned to that frequency, and these are little Baofeng radios that are available on Amazon, for some of them for about $40 and up, and tune it to that frequency, most of you will not have that signal, but a few of you will find the signal. There is a continuous signal in your immediate proximity as well, and when you leave your normal living space, it will go away. I know that because some of my listeners and some of my Dreamland subscribers have already experimented with this.
Okay.
Go ahead.
And is the implication that some people are being monitored or interacted with, perhaps specifically because you have talked about it in a public way, some minds have then picked up on it, then those minds have concentrated on listening to that frequency, and we know that when it comes to the non-humans and the UFO phenomena, concentration of subject and intent in the mind seems to have a lot to do with whatever the consequence or reaction is.
Well, yeah. Well, now I notice that we're getting some interference in our call as well. Some little pops and clicks. I don't know if you can hear them, but I can.
Yeah, I can hear, and it's like general static with periodic points. Now, I do think this is interesting. And does it though? For me to share with you some of the context of other people hearing that double sound since at least March, perhaps February of this year. And only this year, does that help you then say that there is a bigger context for all of this and not specific to you?
Well, that's exactly right. That's precisely what it does. And it's a relief, frankly, because while I don't know what it is, I do think I'm pretty sure now that it's not somebody stalking me with a gun in hand, which is
exactly
my worry.
Yeah. And anybody listening who has heard a single explosive sound or the metallic sound or the metallic clashing, that know that there are a lot of people around the world for a decade who have been reporting these sounds, and I have been one of the few who has stayed on wanting to try to interview people who have heard it and get the sounds when I can. And try to look at the planet as a whole. Are there areas where more of these booms happen than another? And here are two things. One, Mark Wood, the retired Navy captain who works with us periodically, I still remember the day that he's very left brain, very skeptical, very analytical. And he called me and he said, Linda, I just have had an interaction with one of those boom sounds. It shook the entire house. But he said, I can tell you as a longtime person from the Navy that what just happened in my house was like a compression wave coming from above. He said, there's no confusion. It came from above and it hit the second story in my house. Where I was, It hit the second story on only one side of the house. He said, I don't understand what has happened, but I'm telling you, reporting to you immediately, compression wave coming down only on one side of the house, not the other. Now, why was that significant? Going all the way back to 2011, there have been reports, many, where a family will get in touch with me. They are telling me what happened in their house, what they heard. I always say, would you please get in touch with your neighbors to the right and to the left and across the street and see if other people heard these sounds, and can I interview them too? Over and over again, I get the same reply. People call me. I know that they have tried to talk with their neighbors, and they say, Linda, nobody else heard it but us.
This now, in my case, of course, they did. Other people did hear it.
And sometimes they do, but a lot of people not. But what I'm leading to is the complexity and control of whatever this frequency is. It can come from above, and it also can come from below because people, the bottom of people's feet have been hit simultaneously with the sound. A garage door... A police officer coming home for lunch in Georgia, this is about 5 years ago, he's listening on his radio about all the calls that are coming in from five counties in Georgia reporting booms. And as he comes down his street to his house to turn in his driveway and to raise up his garage door, he hears one of these big booms. And he was witness that when he got out of his car, there was a crack in the cement under the track of his garage door that had not been there when he left in the morning. So it's physical impact. It has impact. But why are some compression waves from above? Why are some of these house shaking, cracking of cement from below? And here is another part of the mystery. I have been through earthfiles.com, my news website, and through Earthfiles, the YouTube channel. I always ask if there are scientists, engineers, people who have professions who may have knowledge about these sounds that could get in touch with me and can do it totally anonymously. I always respect that. It's getting information. And in the decade that I have been putting out that request, even though I've gotten feedback on so many other mysteries from people in those categories, when it comes to the booms, the metallic sounds, the trumpet sounds, the sounds of jets where they're in a clear blue sky and nobody can see anything, in all those categories, even though I have received reports from highly trained, educated professionals, I have never once gotten an anonymous report or a professional report requesting anonymity. I do not know if that means that there is no information hidden or secret where people in the government know what's going on and they're not talking. The silence from that community of people who like to be whistleblowers has never existed on the booms, the metallic sounds, the trumpets, and the jets in a blue sky.
Well, so here we are, faced with a mystery. And folks, when Linda and I are finished talking, we're going to play all of the sounds. And for those of you who are listening on audio, you'll hear them and my explanations as of each one as we go along. I'll start with mine, and then we'll play Linda's videos and audios in, as I say, in sequence with explanations. And Linda, I would like to thank you for this, and I have to tell you, I have no theory. You have no theory.
Right.
I can't get away from the fact that the sense in my case that it did have something to do with me, that it wasn't random, and it occurred two times over a 2-week period at the time that I do my 3 a.m. meditation, and I can't know whether it was had hostile intent or not, because the first time it affected the meditation a bit, but not much. I've done doing this for so long that I've experienced plenty of interruptions and not lost my balance. I didn't then either. And then the second time, of course, I wasn't even here. So what can it all mean? Onward and upward, as you say, closing out some emails, ironic cheers.
Yes, it's what keeps us going, I think. The mysteries are not only huge, but they keep proliferating.
Right.
And the more they proliferate, the more energy I actually have wanting to continue to understand them.
Yes.
So I don't think there is any end to this.
And Linda, I want to thank you on behalf of myself and everyone listening. Folks, we couldn't have had this conversation if Linda Moulton Howe had not stuck with these things for years and years and years. She has a vast fund of knowledge about things that the great majority of people in the media simply ignore, and in the sciences, and in the military, and the public moves blindly on down the fog road of the future with no idea what's actually happening. But you do get an idea what's actually happening, because in the case of being one of my listeners, it happens to me.
Right.
And in the case, go ahead.
The Earth Files YouTube channel keeps growing. We've broken through 180,000 subscribers, and that says to me that people around the world are becoming more independent in their own thinking, in their own challenge of what is being denied by governments and power brokers. And that, to me, is healthy. I hope it continues to expand with people trying on their own to ask independent questions and report what happens to them. More and more people are coming forward from police, from medicine, from science, and military, to me, with actually extraordinary experiences. And every single person says, I've never told anyone this before. I'm going to keep unfolding as best I can, trying to do it in some kind of journalistic rule where I'm making the differentiation between that which can be proved, that which is an experience that cannot be proved, but in the context of thousands of human testimonies since World War II.
Linda Moulton Howe, earthfiles.com, and her Earth Files YouTube channel. Make a date with Linda Moulton Howe. I have a lovely date with Linda every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. Pacific time when I settle back and watch that wonderful show while I am texting in my subscriber text group on my website at the same time. So it's a big, big Wednesday night for me.
Linda, thank you, Whitley.
Well, Linda, thank you so much for being with us today and for being so helpful. And folks, stay tuned. We're going to now move through the video and audio records of what we've been talking about. There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved? Can we take it? A new world. It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is, and it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not.
I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook, and Kindle.
The first video I'm going to show is the video taken by my surveillance camera. You'll hear two loud cracking noises, preceded by a sort of whoosh and accompanied by a flash. Now, since I recorded the first part of this video, I've discovered that this was heard much more widely than I thought. It was heard over a square mile area at least. So it's not firecrackers and it's not gunshots. And it almost certainly did come from above, just as the video analyst thought. So what was it? Well, it could have been someone with a drone playing some kind of nasty game with a drone in the middle of the night. I don't think so, though, and here's why. I heard it a couple of weeks before. As I've said, I was sitting in the living room where I do my meditation. The sliding door to my deck was open, and there was absolutely no sound. It was close to 4 o'clock in the morning and dead quiet. I would have heard the faintest sound of a drone in the sky above me. Even if it was a fairly soft drone, I would have heard it almost certainly. The bangs then came out of nowhere. They had the same precise spacing. Now, I can't rule out a drone, but my instinct tells me that this is something else, and I can't say that I know what it is. Before we go on, I want to talk about the Making Contact Conference again. This is going to take place on the island, a virtual campus, on August 18th through the 22nd. Many people are going to be involved. I will be involved, Linda Moulton Howe, Mark Sims, Danny Sheehan, Lou Elizondo, Chris Mellon, and many, many others. It's going to be a major conference. Ralph Blumenthal from the New York Times. So do plan to attend. It's virtual. The cost is $249, $149 if you use the coupon code WHITLEYSAVE100 while you are buying your ticket, and that'll take it down to $149, which is a great deal for a conference like this. Don't miss it, because if you do miss it, you'll miss it forever. Don't do that. It's a major change, this conference. Okay, this is my recording. We'll play it two times, and if you watch and listen closely, you'll hear a sort of whooshing sound, then a flash, and the two reports come very quickly after that. Okay, let's play the recording again. Now we're going to play Linda's two recordings in sequence. Now let's play all three recordings together. Now we're going to be talking to Mia Feroleto about another conference that just happened, the Consciousness and Contact Conference, which was quite astonishing. I had another remarkable experience there of seeing into the other universe. I've detailed that in a blog post on unknowncountry.com in Whitley's journal. So you can go there and read it in detail. Mia, this is the last Consciousness and Contact Conference. She's been holding it for 4 years, and now she's moving on to other things. This is going to be a quite fascinating interview with Mia. And Free Dreamlanders, you'll be hearing it right after these messages.
unknowncountry.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe, in the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago. Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Breakthrough, Majestic, and so much more, powerful meditations. But more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real, and it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us and join, very frankly, the future.
Now we're going to be turning to Mia Feroleto. Mia has been running the Consciousness and Contact Conference either on the Pine Ridge Lakota Sioux Reservation or near it for 4 years, and has just finished the last conference. At the previous conference, or rather the two conferences ago in 2019, I had the remarkable experience of seeing into a parallel universe that I have described in my book, A New World. I saw into it again this time, quite differently, and we'll be talking about that a little later. First, I would like to welcome Mia. She is the editor of New Observations magazine and the podcaster of New Observations podcast on unknowncountry.com and a dear friend. Mia, welcome to Dreamland.
Oh, it's great to be here with you, Whitley, especially after having spent 4 wonderful days in WASTA together just recently.
Yeah,
it was many other great people.
It was an extraordinary conference because the people there were very special. It was a really strong group of people, I thought. There were the usual challenges in terms of physical and infrastructure, but that didn't matter much. What mattered was the just sheer spiritual power of the experience, at least for me. Now, can you tell us a little bit about the history of the conference? And then later we're going to talk about where you're going with it since you're stopping. You started, 4 years ago?
The first conference was in May of 2018 in Verchere, Vermont at the Verchere Riding School. And our lead speaker there was Linda Moulton Howe, Alan Steinfeld spoke, Rebecca Hardcastle, and three other people, animal communicator David Lewis. And interestingly enough, we did not have any visitations that night, but after the conference ended and continuing forward, the Verschier Riding School, which is now under a new name, has regular ET contact and craft showing up. And periodically I receive videos from them saying, you know, look who just arrived. So it's very funny. But that year I went to Pine Ridge for the first time and immediately knew that the conference needed to be moved out to South Dakota. The power, as you know so well, on the Pine Ridge Reservation and the surrounding territory is off the charts and ancient. And if you are receptive to it, it allows you to open up new vistas within your own spiritual center just simply by being there.
Well, from my perception, that's an almost absurd understatement, because I had on the 3 days of the conference in 2019, what is probably the most extraordinary experience of my life, topping even the close encounter experience of 1985.
Wow.
Because it was brain bending. I still looking back, it has awed me, moved me, deeply frustrated me, because I know this is real and it's there. It's another world. And I saw it there on the reservation primarily in 2019. Interestingly enough, this year, I didn't see it so much on the reservation, but I saw something completely new to me, a town, as we were going from Wasta to the reservation and leaving Rapid City. You have to go through Rapid City to do that drive. Suddenly, I was, of course, closing my eyes and trying to see things in the other universe. There appeared on my right a town. It was below the level of the graded highway we were on, and it obviously, whatever roads they had there, they weren't graded. Otherwise, we would have been at ground level there also, and we weren't. And I just glimpsed it for a few minutes, and the seeing was never as clear as it was in 2019. But then we intersected with its own highway, and this highway was an old-fashioned concrete slab highway, well-worn. And also, like the roads I saw in 2019, kind of following the contour of the land rather than a grade. And so the result was, as the other highways went down the hillside that we were on, it felt like the car had taken flight, and I literally lost my stomach, just as if I was in an airplane going up very quickly, just like happened before. Now, I don't think this can happen as an imaginary thing. I think the body has to believe that it has taken flight. And I don't know that there is such a thing as a hallucination that can cause that. So I was just astonished at what I saw. But now let's go on, because this is only one thing in an extraordinary weekend. I want you to give us your impressions of some of the real high points of the weekend for everybody, not just my stuff.
Well, first, I'd like to say that I and many other people who were there felt you gave one of the best presentations of your career. It was stunning.
Thank you.
And very moving. And I, for one, felt Annie there with us throughout your talk and that evening. And
one of the participants said that the white moth, which is of course Annie's avatar, showed up in his surveillance camera at his home while I was giving the talk.
Right, right. So she was definitely with us.
Oh, yeah.
But it was an extraordinary group of attendees and speakers. The speakers were so evolved themselves as individuals, both in terms of their own personal development and their depth of knowledge. And to have brought this group together in the way that we did in such a place with the attendees, who most of whom were also very much on the path. Chief Arville Looking Horse and his wife Paula came and spent Sunday morning with us. And it was fascinating to speak to Paula afterwards and have her talk about your conversation with her and the parallels between what you experienced as a child in school and what Paula experienced. Fascinating.
Paula Looking Horse's, Chief Looking Horse's wife, folks, and in herself, a very powerful and remarkable human being. And we talked extensively about our childhoods, which intersected in such an extraordinary way. Can you tell us a little bit more about Paula's school experience? Because my listeners and viewers already know what happened to me pretty much. I just, for those of you who don't, I was briefly for about 5 or 6 months in a very harsh school environment that was supposedly for super bright kids, but it was, I don't know what it was actually for, but it was very, very difficult, so intense and so harsh that my immune system collapsed and I ended up in the hospital. But go ahead.
Well, both of you are very strong individuals. Paula did not go to the Indian reservation schools like the majority of Native American children. They were taken away from their families at a very early age and their hair was cut. They were not allowed to speak their native language. Paula went to a school called the Little Red Schoolhouse and was one of, I believe, six students in her class who were treated as who they actually are, Native Americans, and allowed to speak their language and allowed to pursue their natural inclinations as well as go to school. And Paula and Chief Arville and a small group of us are now working together to found an indigenous school that will follow that basic path.
Right.
Current children and young adults. But the two of you, there were a number of synchronicities that were happening. You and Paula finding each other was one. Our ley line expert, Peter Champeau, who's a master dowser and comes from a long line of 33 degree Masons, is from Massachusetts, exactly the same place that one of our attendees, Erica Nair, was from. We had multiple Colby College graduates. There was just this very interesting synchronicity of people having their own connections with each other that I personally believe helped intensify the grid that we formed surrounding the geographic locations that we were at during the course of the conference. In speaking in advance to Peter Champeau, we discussed WASTA, the name of which means good water, and the fact that WASTA is a central point for the Lakota Nation. It links, the ley lines link to Pipestone, which is where all the sacred stones come for the making of their pipes, and three other locations, including Devil's Tower, Bear's Lodge. So we were, in a sense, creating this circle around WASTA with this powerful group of people on the full moon, on the summer solstice, the most powerful day of the year, supposedly the beginning of a new phase in the Mayan calendar. And this, the sun dances, many of the sun dances were taking place.
Yes.
So it was this incredibly powerful moment for all of us there. Many of us consciously and many of us not so consciously, or a few of us not so consciously, but half of our time was spent on Pine Ridge, at Wounded Knee, at the Ketch's family property, at Henry Red Cloud's property, which were all so close together and just a few minutes away from where the two FBI agents were killed in the 1970s on the Jumping Bull Ranch, the reason why Leonard Peltier has been in prison for 45 years. So we were concentrated in this very intense, small geographic area. And as you know firsthand, we experienced our own highly emotional, highly charged experience of not being able to stay at the Sundance ceremony,
yes,
even though we were invited to attend it.
Yeah, can you explain that a little bit? Because it turned out to be such a valuable experience, although at the time it didn't seem it would be.
It was critical to everything that happened in terms of the healing work that we as a group were able to do at Wounded Knee, of all places. We had been invited to attend the Sundance ceremony by the family matriarch. And unfortunately, she was not around when we all arrived. And her granddaughter had not been informed that we were coming. So 35 people got out of cars and vans and arrived all excited and you know, ready to participate to the extent that we could. And we were asked to leave. And it was very dramatic. It was highly emotional. And the night before, just before your talk, I had discussed the experience that Native Americans have when they go to Rapid City and the amount of prejudice that they are subjected to and how generally they only go to Rapid City when they absolutely have to. And I described life on Pine Ridge for the average Lakota person, living on less than $5,000 a year, in some cases as little as $3,500, many without running water. It's a very harsh life. It's a beautiful life, and it's a life that for everyone that I've met over these years now of going out there, is full of connection to the land and each other. They represent, in my mind, what humanity is supposed to be. They represent the depth of connectivity to all living things, and Mother Earth and the universe, that we have gotten away from, that Western man has very much, you know, gotten away from for the most part. But that experience at the Sundance gave us the shame, the momentary emotional opening, surprise opening. I mean, this is right out of Carlos Castaneda in so many ways, as far as, you know, shifting your attitude, shifting your focus, shifting your perception. We were shifted immediately into not being the invited guests, but being the interloper, the invader.
Yes.
And we were told to go. And I happened to have had buffalo meat in the car to deliver to Gloria Red Cloud, who was preparing a Lakota meal for us on Sunday night. And I asked Henry if he would speak to us about what had just happened to everyone at the Sundance. And it was such an important meeting with Henry. He dropped everything.
Yeah,
that he was
this was after, folks, just to fill you in, we had to leave the Sundance. We could not participate. We were told to leave. And even though we had been invited and the chiefs were aware of our coming, this young woman could not, she did not want us there. And it wasn't right that we would stay anyway. So we left, and it was a small family affair. There were just a few Sundancers, I think four. And so this arrival of this 35-person strong group was overwhelming. But we had, you know, I have lived a life of working with friction as a tool of spiritual development. This is emphasized very much in the Gurdjieff Foundation and the Gurdjieff work. And the visitors took it up in spades when they came into my life. And it's the way I work with them now. Friction is central to it. So I've looked upon it as a gift, a chance to see myself struggling, my ego struggling with this humiliation and embarrassment, but to see it from the outside. And so to me, it was a very powerful, energetic experience. And the young woman, in her anger and her determination to preserve the integrity of her family ceremony, gave me a tremendous personal gift. But go ahead.
Well, just to back up for a moment, when we reached the checkpoint on the Pine Ridge Reservation to be allowed in, because the COVID checkpoints are still in effect there, I was in at the head of the caravan, and literally 2 minutes after passing the checkpoint, a spotted eagle flew over my car, and two other attendees saw it very clearly. And the Sundance we attended was the Spotted Eagle Sundance. So I very clearly knew that Spirit was saying, you're welcome. You know, what is supposed to happen is going to happen. So even though I was shocked that all of this was transpiring, I was able to, you know, collect everybody and ask Henry if he could speak to us, since he lived just a few minutes down the road. And he gave an extraordinary overview of his experience. Henry Red Cloud is the great-great-grandson of Chief Red Cloud. He himself was made a chief this past September in an extraordinary ceremony at Bear Butte, the most sacred site of the Lakota people. And I was blessed to be able to attend the ceremony and wrapped in my own star quilt with the elders during it, which was a huge honor and blessing. Henry described his own experience of wandering through Walmarts and having store clerks follow him to be sure he wasn't stealing things. Henry has been honored by MIT. He received an honorary doctorate from Washington University a year ago this past spring. He is the Lakota representative at the treaty memorial negotiations that have begun, the Fort Laramie Treaty. Henry was the Lakota representative. So, you know, this is a very special man who's accomplished great things. At least 150,000, perhaps 200,000 trees on the Pine Ridge Reservation. And he's training Native Americans to be solar warriors, to learn about energy conservation and to bring energy, affordable energy, to the reservations.
Right, and he has a remarkable setup there. You can, with classes and so forth, where people can learn how to create solar installations, which is very important because in fact, every place in the world that can become energy independent needs to do that now, and water independent, if at all possible, because we are going into a very disruptive period in the climate history of planet Earth. and it's not going to get better from here. It will not go back to normal. It is going to become more and more difficult to manage over time. And people, for example, on isolated Indian reservations have an excellent chance of getting through this intact if they take the right steps now. And Henry's work is a big part of that.
Absolutely.
Yes.
And they're their own sovereign nation, so they definitely have the ability, a greater chance of survival than we do. So that was critical. But from there, we went to Wounded Knee. And what was so interesting during the conference is the weather had been very harsh. It was well over 100. It was 110 the Tuesday after the conference, the day after the conference ended. But while we were at Wounded Knee having lunch and visiting the memorial, we were just enveloped by this soft sky, this soft gray sky with a very light mist of rain cooling us down. And it was almost as if, in my mind anyway, that the earth was saying, let me support you. You've just been through a traumatic experience. Let me nurture you. Let me protect you. And there were Lakota women selling jewelry, handmade jewelry that they had made. And we had cake. And it happened that it was one of the women was celebrating her birthday that day. So we all had birthday cake together. It was really kind of a wonderful contrast to what we had just experienced. But during our time there, Peter Champeau made offerings. He made tobacco offerings. He made fruit offerings. And he did energetic clearing work surrounding the mass grave where approximately 300 Lakota people are buried from the Wounded Knee siege in 1879, I believe, 89. Yes. And 89. And what was so interesting was how when we were back at the Ketch's property and the young woman was so angry at me and pointing at me, one of our attendees, Siri, saw spirits, grandmother spirits around her, and the spirits were pointing at me too. And at the time, I felt that all of this directed anger and rage was coming at me, historic, traumatic, but very old.
I felt it too. I felt that very strongly coming out of the young niece, very much so. And Siri, by the way, is in and of herself a very interesting person. She's Falcon Dana, one of the daughters of Raven Dana, who had some extraordinary experiences at our cabin in the old days in upstate New York and was present for two of the biggest multiple witness encounters that took place at the cabin. So
another one of these connections that came
right
out, you know, that it's
not surprising that she's got a lot of spiritual energy, which she certainly does.
She does, absolutely. So all of this was going on and our group was taking it in, but also doing alchemical work on it energetically at the same time, to very varying degrees based on, you know, where we're all at and what we're able to handle.
Yes.
But Chief Arville and Paula had many things going on during the conference. And originally they were going to come for 2 days and then it was questionable whether they would be able to come or not. And Paula kept saying to me, you know, Arville keeps saying, I have to keep my word to Mia. And I feel so strongly that he was picking up that all of this was going on an energetic level. And he knew that he had to be there.
And his presence was very welcome.
Very welcome. Yeah, we had two chiefs on either side of us. We had Henry Red Cloud and Chief Arville Looking Horse, two chiefs, kind of grounding us and protecting us and adding their knowledge and wisdom and standing historically, which was extraordinary, an extraordinary gift. So when he came, Arville and Paula came and talked about, he went into some detail about WASTA and the surrounding areas, and Pipestone and Bear Butte and Bear Lodge and the sacred circle and the four directions. And he basically was repeating a variation of what Peter Champeau had told us. And interestingly enough, you could feel things shift on Sunday morning. You could feel like a release and a calm kind of entering the group in a way. And people were very relaxed on Sunday morning, sitting outside. And the air shifted too. It was much cooler than it had been.
Yeah, but I remember the difference.
Yeah. Yeah, you felt really relaxed on Sunday morning, right?
Yeah, I had trouble staying in the meeting hall, in fact, on Saturday because of the heat. So I was, even though it was air conditioned, I was just having trouble handling it. I had to stay out in the breeze. So it was a welcome relief and a very great change too, for sure.
And the talks were incredible. John Lamb Lash joined us from Spain and gave his first public address in 20 years. Phil Borges spoke on shamanism, and I have not had a chance to see that yet, but I've heard incredible things about it.
Yes.
Alana talked about Rudolf Steiner.
That's Alana Freeland.
Alana Freeland, thank you. And it was just an extraordinary group of speakers. All of our presentations will be posted and the links will be available.
We'll make sure the links are available on Unknown Country, of course.
Wonderful. Thank you, Whitley.
Let's talk a little bit about, you're going to be interviewing Peter Champeau in depth on new observations next week, I believe. Yeah, you said. And can you tell us a little bit about him? He's a memorable man. You don't forget it when you meet him.
You don't forget him when you meet him. And actually, Paula Looking Horse introduced the two of us. She and Peter were on a phone call last summer, and she texted me at the same time and said, can you join us for a phone call? And he participates in a number of the activities that Chief Arville and Paula do for World Peace and Prayer Day and other specific celebrations and rituals for energetic clearings. He comes from a long line of 33rd degree Masons, and he has this incredible depth of vision, the likes of which I have perhaps never seen before in another human being.
He is an extraordinary man indeed. And interestingly enough, is he actively a Mason? Do you know?
No, he has gone the other route to work with the ley lines and clear the energy, and you know, serve as a dowser. He's an extremely powerful dowser. His consciousness is unique. I feel really extraordinary. And interestingly enough, you may know this, Whitley, at the Sundance, some of the family members actually invited him to come and sit down with them. And they told him that we were welcome. We were welcome there, that they didn't understand why this was, you know, such a problem. But again, this was the catalyst to create all this movement and action and change.
It was. And I, you know, I think that it was a catalyst, and there was a lot of dissension and disappointment at the Sundance among the family members that we were prevented from going, I'm sure. But I felt like it was right. Everything happened in a way that ultimately was right, should have happened that way.
Yeah, I agree completely. And that allowed us to gain access to a much deeper level of trauma that we would not have been able to access without it happening.
To understand, like when I saw her, the young woman walking up, beautifully dressed in her native traditional clothing, and the expression on her face, I thought of immediately how much oppression and suffering these people have endured, and how she was trying to preserve the integrity of something that is part of her culture that has been so stepped on, for her children especially, who were there. And I could see, I always, you know, the ancient Greeks thought of the bear, as the great bear, as women's stars, because the bear is so protective of her cubs. And I thought to myself, as she came striding up, here comes a bear woman, we're in trouble. We were. So it was a very good experience for me.
It was a critical experience in my meditation for the second time in 3 years. I experienced this profound divine energy coming through. And I was told that the Sundance happened the way it did so that Wounded Knee could have an energetic opening, and that each of us held the energy in us. We held the trauma. We experienced firsthand a small piece of what the Lakota have experienced, and we held it within ourselves for those days. And then by Tuesday morning, we were able to release it. And I was able to see it spread out to the four directions, going through the water and just spreading through all the tributaries and all the veins and reaching out into every direction. It was very beautiful and very powerful. And had not this specific group of people come together, that was it. You know, it was the chemistry of this particular group of people that gathered in Wasta, the central point, and actually went through this series of events, which allowed this alchemical process to happen. Every single piece of it was important to.
Yes, I would agree with you there. I think it was, and I certainly came away from it very much energetically enhanced, I would say. And the conversations we had, you know, and anyone who's been at a conference with me knows I don't hide away at all. I'm always around, and I learned. What? Yeah, absolutely. I'm right there. If you want to see me or talk to me, all you have to do is walk up. But in any case, it was a really good group of people. You know, on the Saturday night, we were all sitting out at the little motel where we were billeted, I guess would be the best way to put it. And I kept seeing these flashes of light in the sky. And I thought maybe it's heat lightning from a storm across the horizon, which is very possible. But then I saw something, a flame come down slowly in the sky. And I pointed it out to a couple of people, but it was gone too quickly. I don't know if anyone else saw it, but it was not a meteor. And it was not a, it was something unusual. It was like an energy discharge of some kind that I hadn't seen before. I wouldn't necessarily say it was a UFO, but it was an unusual, I would say it was an unusual natural effect. And I sensed it had something to do with all of this energy that was flying around at that conference. It was quite incredible.
It really was incredible.
Yeah.
And that's the place. I mean, unusual things happen all the time out there. We're literally 10 minutes from the Badlands, which is one of my favorite places I've ever been to. It's just so magical and powerful and beautiful. And, you know, leaving Pine Ridge that afternoon, that Friday afternoon after the Sundance, to have seen the buffalo wait. I understand that you and Siri got out of the car to see the buffalo by the side of,
We were fussed at, but I did it anyway. I've been close to many buffalo in my life, and I know how you walk up on them without getting them excited, but no one knew I knew that. So I was, and I shouldn't have done it anyway because we were told not to. I'm bad that way.
Yeah, I understand.
I'm always ending up in places I'm not wanted. I don't really care.
So when you got back home to California, did you notice any differences, or how did it feel?
I feel like there is a focusing going on, because there's a the visitors, in my experience, have a tremendous amount of interest in and connection with people with older relationships to the world and the planet, and relationships that probably involved them a long time ago much more overtly than they do now. And the Native American tribes of North America are certainly on that list. And so every time I'm there and I'm with them, I come back feeling that I know the visitors a little better. And because, believe me, I mean, they're not Flash Gordon at all. They're very strange, but they're also, when you're with them and around them, even in a non-physical way, there is an ordinariness to them. In other words, they don't think of themselves as some kind of highfalutin demigods or anything. They're just very ordinary and very humble but very, very determined that the best energy possible emerge. And that often takes work. I mean, it's often hard and it's often frightening. And like at the Sundance, that was a classic example of how an energetic experience with the visitors feels. Very unexpected, a complete overturning of your expectations in the moment, and not easy to deal with, but you gain from it. And I feel like I took some of that energy with me. I feel it in me right now. It was a very energizing experience. I'm awfully glad I went.
Oh, we're all so glad you came, Whitley. It was having you there. And I you know, the whole reason why I started organizing this conference was to share my personal journey with others. I decided 4 years ago that, rather than have these experiences myself, I wanted to reach out and try to find my tribe, so to speak, and share, share my own journey. And essentially each year I just create or organize events that have happened for me and welcome the speakers and the audience in to experience them themselves and believe that, you know, the people who come at that moment are there for a reason and that whatever is supposed to happen will happen. And consistently each year that has been true. There have been profound events each year and everyone has gone away to the best of my knowledge with enhanced psychic and other abilities just from having gone through that the experience of being there.
Which certainly happened to me in 2019 in ultimate spades and happened to me this time too, although the seeing I had wasn't as clear as it was in 2019. In some senses, it was more useful because I saw that town, and I've written a blog about it, folks, on Unknown Country. You can read it there in Whitley's journal. Now, Mia, I want to go on. You're not doing the conference anymore. What are you going to be doing? Because I know you haven't left WASTA and Pine Ridge forever by any means.
Well, as you know, my background is in fine art. Among other things, I created Art Walk New York, which raised $25 million for Coalition for the Homeless and has been duplicated around the country. And one of my dreams was always to create a residency program for artists and writers. Creative people are really leading the revolution. They're leading in one way or another the spiritual path as well for all of us because they're kind of the visionaries who are showing us the way. And they're shaman, most of them in their own right as well. So what we cover in the conference will now be integrated into the residency program for artists and writers who will spend time on Pine Ridge. And bring that information again, like we're all ambassadors. We've become ambassadors to take the experience that we have together these past 4 years. And I just want to interject that this has been my own personal Sundance. To become a Sundancer, it takes 4 years. And this has been my spiritual offering, so to speak, to share what I have learned in my years on the planet with others. And as Whitley can tell you, I did all the cooking for the second year in
you
a
did.
Row. Right. I did.
Fortunately, she's a pretty good cook.
Thank you. But, you know, food is nurturing. And when I'm doing the cooking or when anyone is doing the cooking, and the Lakota acknowledge this, you're putting your energy, your creativity, your love, your energy into the food that you're preparing. So that was an extra little offering on my part. But the idea through the residency program, I'm going up to Cornell University in a few weeks to meet with members of the art department, and I'm in touch with several other institutions of higher learning. We want to bring college and graduate students out to WASTA to make art and also interact on Pine Ridge. And we are launching by the end of the year a project called the Adopt an Artist Program, which I've been working on for 10 years. And the idea is to send artists around the world to make their work, but have them be exposed to communities in direct ways, just like the Greeks and Romans have art become an integral part in daily life at the same time when the public school system is eliminating art at the arts from their curriculum because of budget cuts. It's so important because the greatest gift you can give to a person, it certainly has been true in my life, is to access your own creativity. If you can be an artist and make from nothing on a blank piece of paper, you know, at will, you can problem solve in any area of your life and come up with creative solutions. And as you said earlier, now is the time we're going to need creative solutions for so many problems. So
exactly.
It's all connected. So and that's then, what you're doing.
Well, and you're also working on New Observations magazine, and I hope on the podcast.
And on the podcast, yes, absolutely. The magazine, our most recent issue is by Stephen Paul Miller, who's a historian and poet. And it's on post-World War II, the post-World War II economy. And coincidentally, on July 12th, there was an important meeting between descendants of FDR and other members of the New Deal and the Biden administration about the New Deal. And they were all given New Observations magazine to read before the meeting on July 12th, which is pretty cool.
Yeah, the magazine gets around.
It does, doesn't it?
That's for sure. Okay, Mia, I think we're coming to the end of our time together. And I would like to thank you so much for spending some time with us on Dreamland and telling us about what to me was another completely amazing experience at the conference. I have to say, I wish you were still doing it, but 4 years, I understand the reason that 4 years is the extent of your involvement. And I want to wish you all the best. And I'm looking forward to your interview with Peter Champeau on New Observations, on the New Observations podcast, because I know it's going to be fascinating. Thank you very much for being with us on Dreamland.
Thank you so much, Whitley. It's been my honor to be here with you. Bye for now.
Bye now.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.